Greetings, Ranger fans. Jake here for a deeper look at episode 19 of Power Rangers Dino Fury, The Makeover. But first, a rapid run-through. Let's kick off the counter. It's Morphin time! Okay, so we open on a Buzz Blast news report as Dr. O'Connor reveals the recent excavation of a pirate chest.
It be Purplebeard's treasure.
And Jay Borg interviews the museum curator,
Beatrice Cotton,
about how they hope to find Purplebeard's magic talismans when they open it up.
But they haven't yet, so it's a short interview.
A light falls over and nearly hits Beatrice, but it's Pop-Pop to the rescue!
And let the elderly flirting puns commence.
She invites him to lunch and Amelia offers to help him get ready, while in Area 62, Void Knight schemes to steal Purplebeard's talismans using his latest Sporix beast.
Bone Switch.
He switches Slither and Mucus's bodies back and forth, which doesn't feel super relevant to the task, but he attacks the museum anyway, interrupting Amelia's online shopping spree to give Pop-Pop a snazzy new style, and interrupting Zato introducing the moral of the day.
Being yourself shouldn't be complicated, right?
So at the museum, Bone Switch finds the chest empty, smashes it, and surprise, switches up the Rangers' bodies.
Now Zato's Amelia, Amelia's Zato, Javi's Ollie, and Ollie's Javi.
This breaks their morph, so Izzy and Ion are the only ones left to fight the henchmen and Bone Switch, who escapes Ion's Electro Fury Blade Blast attack.
Hopefully there was insurance.
Solon and Ollie's Javi try to crack the morphin problem while Amelia as Zato convinces Zato as Amelia to help her help Pop-Pop on his date by giving him an earpiece so that she can still give him advice.
Because body switching switches voices for some reason.
And at the date, giving snazzy suited Pop-Pop some cologne.
May attract bees?
During the date, he tries to be respectable, but a bee shows up and he knocks his earpiece straight into the cream broccoli soup, and when he runs to change, Zato as Amelia calms down by recommending that he just be himself.
Cute awkward kiss on the cheek.
Of course, Beatrice likes his greasy coveralls, the date goes smoothly, and back at the base, the Rangers realize they need to switch their powers along with their bodies, allowing them to morph again when Bone Switch attacks Palm Plaza.
And now Ion's a pigeon.
The rest fight normally until Bone Switch grows, so they summon the Dino Fury Megazord Warrior Formation, snap off his horns, return everybody to normal, switch back their Dino Keys, and let the Mosa Razorzord finish the job, dropping off her fresh Sporix for Void Knight.
But at least no more worms for Ion?
At the museum, Amelia apologizes for Pop-Pop's makeover, and they learn the pieces of the broken chest act like a jigsaw puzzle treasure map, showing that Purplebeard's talismans were really a pair of Ranger keys that just so happened to be buried at Dino Henge so the Rangers could go dig them up.
Roll credits.
And that's the end of the episode. Now, let's take a deeper look. Body switching plots are nothing new to Power Rangers, with the first instance dating all the way back to episode 16 of Mighty Morphin, Switching Places, and has since recurred occasionally in episodes like Invasion of the Body Switcher and Recognition, although those were both cases of villains masquerading as Rangers, with Body Switcher being particularly ironic since that was technically more of a case of shifting disguises than having any literal body switching. But it seems to have become a far more common trope over the course of the last decade or so, with Super Samurais trading places, Super Megaforces the grass is always greener or bluer, Dino Supercharges Freaky Fight Day, and Beast Morphers the Silva Switch all being body swap episodes. And interestingly, all appear to be in season 2 of their respective installments. Weird. So that's one way this one is different. But another odd pattern that I've been noticing as these types of episodes become more common is that they appear to be taking their cues off Ninja Storm's Sensei Switcheroo and choosing not only to switch minds, but also voices, which is jarring. Putting aside that vocal cord swaps make even less sense than swapping the need for glasses, as we saw between Kim and Billy in the original Switching Places, I feel like it creates an awkward and unnecessary production complication, as the actors then have to lip-sync each other in post, leaving the door open for differences in audio quality and awkward disconnects between facial and vocal performances. It also just... It just creeps me out, to be honest. You really need to walk a fine line to make this sort of thing work. This is especially true with Power Rangers, where there is already a ton of voiceover work happening in every episode, and switching around which character has which voice can very quickly become very confusing, as was the case with Freaky Fight Day choosing to swap all of the Dino Charge Ranger voices around in the middle of a fight scene, meaning that the audience had to keep reminding themselves who was speaking at any given time. On the other hand, you have episodes like The Sensei Switcheroo and The Silva Switch, where a single ranger has their voice swapped with a character that was already using ADR, and the primary focus was placed on the comedy of the civilian scenes, keeping the changes in vocal performance clean and clear. Of course, there are still exceptions to that situation, like Super Ninja Steel's vocal swap episode, Happy to Be Me. Just giving Levi the voice of an old man, and then the body of a child was just... It was super weird. But perhaps the biggest issue I have with voice swapping between Rangers during a body swap episode is that it undermines part of the charm of the original premise in Switching Places, which is to see how effectively the actors can convey characters that are not their own, while at the same time having those characters try to pass themselves off too. This creates the hilarious scenario of the actors portraying an alternate character's interpretation of the characters they usually play, which, interestingly in this episode, only applied to Hunter Denno playing Zato's interpretation of Amelia, while all the other characters just spent the episode hiding away in the base or the bushes, just being themselves.
Well, the versions of themselves that were the voices, not the versions of themselves that were physically... You know what I mean.
And honestly, Ollie and Javi's voices are so similar that I genuinely needed to keep reminding myself that there was even a vocal swap happening there.
Which brings me to the subject of characterization, and the reason that these types of episodes often tend to be during the second half of a series run. We need to know these characters well enough, and they need to be differentiated well enough, that we can still pick up on subtleties in performance when the actor playing the character gets changed up.
In episodes like The Grass is Always Greener or Bluer and Freaky Fight Day, any sense of subtlety or nuance is largely ignored, as the characters almost all end up swapping clothes, basically choosing to focus on superficial markers of the body swap, despite the fact that anyone in that situation would obviously be trying to hide their predicaments, not draw attention to it.
But this episode didn't do that.
Which means that that was basically an unnecessary tangent.
But the point I was trying to make is that this episode does veer a bit far in the opposite direction, underplaying the performances and really relying more upon the premise of the situation and the specifics of the dialogue to sell the characterization quirks.
For instance, outside of Ollie as Javi being the one to hash things out with Solon, and Javi as Ollie making mention of not having tough enough fingers to play guitar, there's no real notable change in facial expressions or body language, and very little that actually conveys what should be a very weird experience for the two of them.
Ion does sell his role as a pigeon, though.
Mosa Fury Pigeon Power!
It also becomes quite obvious during the final ground fight that the source material of the original Ryu Soldier episode did not have body swapping as part of the plot, as the Rangers are all able to morph into what essentially are their default Ranger forms, and then fight as they normally would once the nature of Bone Switch's power is understood.
This scene especially feels like a massive missed opportunity, because we initially see Zato and Amelia's body about to morph into the Red Ranger, and Amelia and Zato's body about to morph into the Pink Ranger, and it looks like we're about to see a female-bodied Red Ranger and male-bodied Pink Ranger, and then they're just in their normal Ranger bodies.
And yes, I know that would have required original footage, and probably tailor-made original costumes as well, but it just would have been such a cool twist.
And would it really have been all that much more expensive than renting that forklift for the day?
But enough on all of the history and intricacies of doing a body swap episode. Let's talk about the rest of the episode surrounding that premise. And I will give credit for the moral of the story actually being quite thematically appropriate, as Pop-Pop ironically learns about being himself from Zato and Amelia secretly literally not being themselves.
It's clear that the writers were drawing parallels between the being yourself lesson from previous body swap plots, like Ivan as Riley learning to respect his descendant Zack in Freaky Fight Day, and the similar being yourself lesson from previous awkward date episodes, like the original Mighty Morphin Season 1 finale, Oyster Stew.
Also, yes, the whole thing with the bees and be yourself, that was cute.
But why would you have a cologne that attracts bees? Why would you do that?
Unfortunately, this sequence does rely a bit upon cringe humor, which I mentioned before with the last awkward attempted date scene back in The Matchmaker, is really not to my personal tastes. But I am grateful that this element quickly gave way to Pop-Pop and Beatrice experiencing genuine heartfelt connection and allowing the humor to flow more naturally from their respective quirks.
And these are the sorts of moments where the episode is at its best, seeing Pop-Pop and Beatrice share those silly little puns and enjoy each other's company, or when we see Zato honestly extolling Pop-Pop's natural virtues.
Also, they consistently give Zato the best lines of the episode.
Seriously, between advocating for Pop-Pop and his deadpan observations of just how bizarre it was to switch bodies, I feel like he was acting as the audience avatar this week.
This highlights the stronger characterization here. While the others have interests that tend to define them, like science, music, and the supernatural, Zato is more clearly defined by his level-headedness and awkward confusion over the human world, as well as an occasional understated exasperation with the impulsiveness of his teammates, which shone through every line he delivered out of Amelia's body.
That's not to say that the others don't have their own personalities outside of their interests, like Amelia getting carried away with things still being conveyed through her scheme for Pop-Pop.
This just felt a little bit more like a plot-related characterization rather than a more dialogue-driven one. Also, this was ironically one of the few cases where Ollie's arrogance wasn't on display, even though it would have better communicated the transfer of character, while Javi... Actually, I'm still struggling to get a bead on Javi. He's, apologetic? That's something he tends to do both here and elsewhere, right? This episode very much tripled down on the lesson of be yourself, conveying it through the body swap plot, the titular makeover, and the pun-driven bee-infested date, which is why I'm harping so much on the stronger characterizations necessary for that message to come through clearly, rather than focusing on things like Purplebeard's treasure chest or the teaser element of the new dino keys from the end of the episode. With the season nearing its end, it does feel like there's a push to make sure that all of these characters are fully realized, extended not only to the Rangers, but to the supporting cast as well, with Jayborg becoming a more confident journalist, Dr. Akana becoming a more active ally to the Rangers, and Pop-Pop becoming more fleshed out through his romance with Beatrice, and finally revealing his real name of Ed Jones. Still curious if his background with Area 62 will play into the final episodes, though. At least this episode finally put to rest my theory that he's secretly Jayborg. So make sure to join me next time for a deeper look at episode 20 of Power Rangers Dino Fury, Waking Nightmares. And if you would like to share this week's rapid run-through, you can find it as a standalone clip over at Morphin Legacy's YouTube channel. Please like, share, subscribe to us both, ring the bell for future notifications, and until next time, farewell, Ranger fans, and let the power protect you.